So we have already studied about the bacteria. Now we know that the bacteria are prokaryotic unicellular organisms which causes, and we are particularly concerned about the infections caused by certain bacteria. So we have already divided the bacteria into three categories. One is gram positive, one is gram negative, and the others. We already know what is gram positive, we already know what is gram staining. Based on the gram staining, we label the bacteria as gram positive and gram negative. And also, we know the structural differences between the gram positive and gram negative bacteria. So, once a quick recap, the cell wall of gram positive bacteria, if you see, the cell wall of gram-positive bacteria is composed of thick cell wall made up of peptidoglycan, right here. Peptidoglycan, thick cell wall. Gram-positive contains thick cell wall, whereas gram-negative contains a thin cell wall made up of same peptidoglycans, but this cell wall is covered by an outer membrane, bilipid layer membrane, and inner bilipid layer membrane, which is cell membrane, right? One more characteristic difference between gram positive and gram negative, apart from the thin cell wall and having two membranes, right, the outer membrane and the inner membrane, in gram negative there are some more differences, which are the presence of lipopolysaccharides. See here, the presence of lipopolysaccharides in gram negative bacteria, and this lipopolysaccharide, the lipopolysaccharides embedded in the gram-negative bacteria, see these things, they are responsible for causing the endotoxemias, or they are responsible for releasing the endotoxins. Now, what are endotoxins? So, the toxins released by bacteria are of two types. One is exotoxin and one is endotoxin. The exotoxins are produced by all type of pathogenic bacteria. The exotoxins are produced by all type of bacteria, right? So gram positive also produces exotoxins and gram negative also produces exotoxins. Exotoxins are proteinaceous secretions by the bacteria, and these proteinaceous secretions, or these proteins of the bacteria, they go and damage the host cell. There are one more type of toxins called as endotoxins, but these endotoxins are produced only by gram negative. And from where do they produce this endotoxin? From the lipopolysaccharides. This lipopolysaccharide acts as endotoxin, right? So once again, gram negative produces both exotoxins and endotoxins, whereas gram positive produces only exotoxins. That is why gram negative bacteria are more dangerous. But you can also remember that the staining of gram negative bacteria is red, and red is for danger, right? So the red stained gram negative bacteria produces both exotoxins and endotoxins. Now, why I am stressing on this exotoxins and endotoxins is because the gram negative bacteria, they are more dangerous. We are going to study them today. So gram negative bacteria are more dangerous. Even if the bacteria is dead, then also these endotoxins in the cell wall, in the outer membrane of the cells of gram negative, are released into the blood even after their death. Even after they are dead by the antibiotic, then also these endotoxins are released, and they causes endotoxic shock, or they causes septic shock. So the person is at much more greater risk when he or she is infected with gram-negative bacteria. So we have already studied gram-positive bacteria. We already know that the gram-positive bacteria with the common, the first gram-positive bacteria that we studied was pneumococcal, right? That is streptococcal, Streptococcus pneumoniae. Then we studied staphylococcal bacteria. Then we studied some clostridial bacteria. Then we studied some diphtheria bacteria. These are the the enterococcal bacteria. So these are the common, the most common bacteria which are gram positive. You should always remember them. We will also study them when we will go into the different systems. For example, in respiratory system pathologies, we have already studied the streptococcal and staphylococcal bacteria and many gram negative bacteria also. So today we are going to start with gram negative bacteria. Gram negative bacteria. So we already know that the stain acquired by the bacteria which are gram negative is red. So the common gram negative bacteria are these: meningococcal infections, gonococcal infections, Klebsiella, Neisseria, gonorrhea, Salmonella, Shigella, Bordetella, Haemophilus, E. coli, Pseudomonas, H. pylori and cholera. We are going to study them. Gonococcal. First is gonococcal infections. Gonococcal infections, they infect the gonads. Right? So you can see this is a male genital organ and you can see this whitish pus like discharge. So if somebody is suffering like this, then probably the person is having a gonorrhea infection. Right? Gonorrhea is a sexually transmitted disease. And it manifests as cervicitis, inflammation of the cervix, urethritis, proctitis, and conjunctivitis, right? So mucopurulent discharge and pain while micturition, dysuria, penile discharge are the most common infections, right? So the gonococcal infections are STD infections and they mostly causes, and they causes sexually transmitted disease named as gonorrhea. Then meningococcal infections, the name itself is suggesting meningococcal. Meningio means meninges, the meninges which surrounds the brain and the spinal cord. So this Neisseria meningitidis, the bacteria is Neisseria meningitidis, it causes meningitis, the inflammation of the meninges of the brain and spinal cord, right? So these meningococcal bacteria, the common is Neisseria meningitidis, and these causes meningitis, right? Now, whenever there is inflammation of these meninges, the person will be having some CNS abnormalities, CNS pathologies. For example, knuckle rigidity, the stiff neck, the person's neck will be having a stiffness. The Kernig sign, we will study this in practical classes. The Kernig signs will be positive and there will be certain other CNS manifestations like headache, like irritability, like deliriums, right? So meningococcal infections causes meningitis most commonly. They can also cause pneumonia. They can also cause arthritis. They can also cause osteomyelitis, pericarditis, right? But you have to remember that the meningococcal infections are gram-negative infections and they mostly causes meningitis. The next is whooping cough. In small children, this whooping cough is a big problem and we give vaccine for this pertussis, right? And Bordella pertussis is the infectious agent responsible for whooping cough. Why it is called as whooping cough? Because the child whoops. When he cough, he produces a sound which comes like whoop, whoop, whoop. Like that, he coughs. And he continuously coughs like that. Right? So it is very common in children, but nowadays, because of the vaccine, it is less common. Then we have next Pseudomonas. We have already studied Pseudomonas in respiratory infections, where we have studied that the Pseudomonas is the most common gram-negative bacteria which causes ventilator associated pneumonia, right? In ventilator, when a person is in the ICU and is on the ventilator, he is most at the risk to catch a pneumonia, and that too caused by Pseudomonas aeruginosa. It is a very dangerous bacteria which is multi-drug resistant most of the times, and it is the main cause for ventilator associated pneumonia. You should always remember the name Pseudomonas. Pseudomonas is a very dangerous organism, gram-negative bacteria, right? And the patients who are at risk are the immunosuppressed patients, immunocompromised patients, and patients who have cystic fibrosis, right? Cystic fibrosis of the lungs, which produces more mucus in their respiratory tract, and it is resistant pathogen, right? Hospital acquired infections and ventilator associated pneumonias, it is the main cause, right? It is a nosocomial infection. It causes nosocomial, that means hospital acquired infection, right? Apart from pneumonia, it also causes UTI. Pseudomonas is an important cause for UTI, urinary tract infections, post-burn infections. When a person is burned, when a person has got burns, then after the burns, the area gets infectious, and Pseudomonas is the first organism to inhabit that burn. Septic shock, folliculitis. Folliculitis is the infection of the hair root follicle, right? Also called as hot tub folliculitis, you know, because this bacteria, it stays in the water in the hot tubs, and the people and the people who take more baths in the hot tubs, they are more prone to get this hot tub folliculitis, where it is present over a very large area of the body. Many hair follicles are infected. Skin infections, it causes gangrenes of the skin, ecthyma gangrenosum, the infection, the ulcer, the infection over the skin looks like an ulcer. And that ulcerous infection becomes gangrenous, right? So that is ecthyma gangrenosum. Osteomyelitis. Osteomyelitis is the infection of the bone. So next organism is Klebsiella. So after Pseudomonas, the second most common ventilator associated pneumonia cause is Pseudomonas. So Klebsiella and the Pseudomonas, you should never forget. Right? Apart from the pneumonia, Klebsiella also causes other infections like urinary tract infections, thrombophlebitis, right? Thrombophlebitis, which is the infection of the blood vessels, wound infections, osteomyelitis, meningitis, bacteremia, sepsis, right? And this is also, Klebsiella is also resistant to beta-lactam antibiotics like ampicillins, right? Then we have Haemophilus influenzae. Haemophilus influenzae. Now, this Haemophilus influenzae bacteria, it sounds like influenza, but it has nothing to do with influenza. Right? Haemophilus influenzae is the most common strain responsible for severe pneumonia, meningitis, and other infections. Right? And for this Haemophilus influenzae, we give vaccine when a child is born at 6th week, 10th week, and 14th week. And this vaccine is called as HIB vaccine, H-I-B. This Haemophilus influenzae type B is named as HIB, HIB infections. So this Haemophilus influenza causes pneumonia, and it is not an influenza virus. It is a bacteria, and that too a gram-negative bacteria. Right? Always remember, gram-negative bacteria have both endotoxins and exotoxins, and gram-negative bacteria are more dangerous. That is why they stain. That is how you can remember, they stain red in gram stain, right? So COPD patients are generally having acute episodes of breathlessness, and these COPD exacerbations are generally limited, generally caused due to the acute bacterial infections, and Haemophilus is one among them. Haemophilus influenzae is one among them, where already a COPD patient gets an acute exacerbation. Cough, sputum production, shortness of breath, fever, and all the symptoms of pneumonia, right? Haemophilus influenzae is very common among AIDS patient also, right? Then after Haemophilus, we have Salmonella. So we have already covered the gram-negative bacteria which causes the pneumonia, right? Which causes the pneumonia, like Haemophilus influenzae, Klebsiella, Pseudomonas, right? So Pseudomonas, Klebsiella, and Haemophilus influenzae we have covered, which causes the lower respiratory tract infections and which are gram-negative bacteria. Now we are talking about the next group, that is Salmonella and all. So this Salmonella is very important gram-negative bacteria. It is very important cause of the infection. See, I have put only the very, very important bacteria. Otherwise, there are so many bacteria which causes infection. So this Salmonella can be divided into two groups. Typhoidal Salmonella. We have already studied typhoidal Salmonella and non-typhoidal Salmonella. Typhoidal Salmonella, which causes typhoid or enteric fever, one and the same thing. Salmonella typhi and Salmonella paratyphi, which causes enteric fever, can be categorized under typhoidal Salmonella because it causes typhoid, that is why it is called as typhoidal Salmonella. And non-typhoidal Salmonella are Salmonella typhi medium, enteritis, Newport and others. Right? See this fork? Can you see this fork? It has a bacteria in it, right? Now you have to guess why the fork and the bacteria are given in this picture together. So typhoidal Salmonella, we have already studied typhoid, so I will not go into very much detail. You can read the text for it. So we already know that it causes a typhoid fever, and the mode of transmission is fecal-oral transmission, contaminated food. That is why the fork and the bacteria was drawn in the previous slide. Right, Salmonella typhi and Salmonella paratyphi causes enteric fever. So what type of fever we get in typhoidal fever? Stepladder fever. Always remember, stepladder fever. The fever increases day by day and it never touches the baseline. The Salmonella survived the antimicrobial environment of the macrophage, right? It is a very dangerous, very notorious bacteria. Fever, abdominal pain, right, the chest rose spots and other things which we have studied, hepatosplenomegaly. Then coming to the non-typhoidal Salmonella. Non-typhoidal Salmonella also causes gastroenteritis as that of typhoidal Salmonella. Typhoidal Salmonella, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, right? This gastroenteritis means the infection of the gastrum and the enterum, that means the stomach and the intestines, right? So non-typhoidal Salmonella causes gastroenteritis, right? But it is not as dangerous as that of typhoidal Salmonella. Then we have next after Salmonella, Shigella. See, this Salmonella, Shigella and others, they are, now we are talking about the bacterias which causes the GIT troubles. So Shigella is the most common cause for dysentery. Right, dysentery. Now what is dysentery? What is diarrhea and dysentery? You can look at this picture. Right, here the person is suffering with diarrhea and here the person is suffering with dysentery. Right, in diarrhea the person is having increased frequency of stools, whereas in dysentery the person, along with the increased frequency of stool, person is having severe abdominal cramping pain. Right, so dysentery is a clinical syndrome of fever, intestinal cramps and frequent passage of small bloody mucopurulent stools. So stool could be bloody, right? Or when the stools are bloody associated with cramps, the abdominal cramps, then we call that as dysentery, and Shigella is the most common cause for dysentery, right? So Shigella is one of the top four pathogens which causes diarrhea, right? Diarrhea means loose stools, loose motions. E. coli, Shigella, Salmonella, Campylobacter, these are the most common bacteria which causes diarrhea. We will again study this diarrhea, dysentery in GIT infections in the coming classes, right? So this Shigella causes Shigellosis dysentery, or it is also called as bacillary dysentery, right? So it is very common in pediatric group or in patients where the patients who do not follow hygiene policies, right? And it also causes outbreaks. It is the cause of endemics, right? Waterborne, foodborne infection, fecal-oral transmissions, Shigella. Never forget Shigella. Then we have next diarrhea-causing bacteria, that is cholera. Very important, cholera. The bacteria name is, the cholera is the disease name. The bacteria is Vibrio cholerae. Vibrio cholerae, right? So it results in profound progressive diarrhea, and which leads to progressive dehydration and death. See, this is how the stool looks like. And how it is looking like? Rice water, right? Rice water. And if too much fluid comes out of the body through the fecal matter, right, if the too much stool gets out of the body and it the too much water gets out of the body, the person will go into hypovolemic shock. The person will go into hypovolemia and hypovolemic shock and death, right? So it is very important to rehydrate the patient suffering with diarrhea or dysentery, right? So this cholera is also called as, the stool in cholera is also called as rice water stool, because it resembles the water in which rice has been washed, right? So if the fluid loss is less than 5%, the person will develop severe thirst. If it is 5 to 10%, the person will get postural hypotension, weakness, tachycardia, right? Hypotension is low blood pressure. Then weakness, tachycardia is increased heart rate. Decreased skin turgor, the normal turgor of the skin will decrease, right? And then if it is more than 10%, the person will get oliguria. The person will not be passing urine much, will be passing less urine. Weak or absent pulses, the eyes will be sunken, right? The wrinkled skin, the skin will become wrinkled, right? And person will go into coma. So cholera is important cause for diarrhea. So next, E. coli. So the most common cause for diarrhea in humans is E. coli. Right, so this E. coli is a very good bacteria. Otherwise, if not causing the pathogenesis, it resides in the human intestine, and it does not cause any pathologies. But when it do, we call those strains by several names. The common are Sija toxin producing E. coli, STEC. The E. coli which produces Sija toxin, and when this stick, Sija toxin producing E. coli infects person, it causes bloody diarrhea, right? The diarrhea associated with bloody stools, the stools mixed with blood. And then we have UPEC, uropathogenic E. coli. It causes mostly urinary tract infections. The urinary tract infection, the most common organism is again E. coli. The GIT infections causing diarrhea, the most common organism is E. coli. So then enterotoxigenic, right? Enterotoxigenic is also very important. Enterotoxigenic, which is, it produces a, this bacteria is toxic to enterum. It is toxic to the GIT. So it is the most common cause for traveler's diarrhea. Traveler's diarrhea, right? Traveler's diarrhea, also food poisoning. Also, it is commonly called as food poisoning, right? So traveler's diarrhea, if somebody is traveling, if somebody from the foreign country has come to you, or you have traveled to some other distance, some other place, and have got the diarrhea, we generally, the E. coli enterotoxigenic strain is responsible for it. Then enterohemorrhagic, right? Hemorrhagic means it will cause bleeding, right? So it will lead to hemolytic uremic syndrome. It will lead to hemolytic uremic syndrome, where excess of RBCs, excess breakdown of RBCs in the blood takes place, and that hemoglobin passes through the urine, and that is called as hemolytic uremic syndrome. The urea is also increased in the blood, and there is excessive hemolysis in the blood, right? So E. coli is the, always remember, E. coli is the important cause for diarrhea and UTI also. Then we have next bacteria, Helicobacter pylori. Now we already know that the bacteria are very resistant prokaryotic organisms, right? Prokaryotic organisms means they don't have membrane bound cell organelles, and they have 70S ribosomes in them. And these bacteria, they have a well rigid cell wall, and that cell wall helps them to thrive in extreme of the situations, like in stomach, where there is release of acid, right? Where there is release of hydrochloric acid in the stomach. And then also these bacteria can survive very easily in stomach walls, right? And this Helicobacter pylori, it causes gastritis, that is inflammation of the gastric mucosa, and it also may cause gastric adenocarcinoma, that is cancer of the gastrum, right? most commonly it is the cause for peptic ulceration, right? It causes gastritis and ultimately it will lead to ulcer formations in the stomach, right? Peptic ulcerations. Then we have gastric adenocarcinomas and gastric lymphomas are also called by Helicobacter pylori. Very important organism, H. pylori or Helicobacter pylori. Then we have next important bacteria as Haemophilus Dusrae. Haemophilus Dusrae, it causes a sexually transmitted disease called as Chancroid, right? So this Chancroid is a sexually transmitted disease and it is characterized by genital ulceration. This is the male genital organ and you can see these ulcers present over the male genital organs, right? Inguinal adenitis, that is inflammation of the inguinal lymph nodes, right? So this Haemophilus Dusrae causes Chancroid. Always remember Chancroid. Tender inguinal lymph nodes, right? And sometimes these inguinal lymph nodes, right? The inguinal lymph nodes here, they rupture also, which is not a very good conditions, right? These genital ulcers are multiple, right? See, 1, 2, they are multiple, they are not one, and they are painful. They are painful. There is pain in them. Why I am stressing on this? Because we will study one more disease where we will find similar ulcers, but they will not be painful. So they are multiple, the ulcers are multiple and they are painful, and the disease is called as Chancroid, caused by Haemophilus Dusrae, which is a gram-negative bacteria. Then we have plague. Now this plague, today we don't know much about plague. Today we are not concerned about the plague, but there was a time when this plague was an pandemic and it causes the most of the deaths due to any infectious cause, right? We have been hit by three major plagues which we have recorded so far: plague of Justinian, the Black Death, the second plague, and the third, the modern plague. The plague of Justinian in 6th century, it killed many people. We have no record of that. The Black Death, it killed approximately 50 million people, and the modern plague in 19th century, right, which killed approximately 10 million lives. So you can just imagine how much big pandemic it was. Even today, people, the old people, they are afraid by the name of plague, and everything which is deadly is sometimes synonymously called as plague. The disease which is deadly, which is endemic, which is pandemic, it is called as plague. So this plague is caused by the bacteria Yersinia pestis, and this Yersinia pestis, it basically this flea, the rat flea, the flea which resides over the rat, this Yersinia pestis is the rat flea is the vector for it, right? This Yersinia pestis, the oriental rat flea, this Xenopsylla chiopis, the oriental rat flea is the vector for it, and this flea over the rat transmits this bacteria into the human. When this flea bites the human gets the plague, right? Not just by biting, this plague when it also spreads from human to human. From human to human, it spreads through air, through aerosols also, right? So once only one flea has bitten a human, then it starts spreading from human to human. Not necessarily all humans are to be bitten by this flea, right? So it is a dangerous condition. So plague, right, especially when we had a very limited set of antibiotics or we did not have antibiotics, this plague was a very big problem. So this plague, we will study about this later in detail, maybe in your next classes or in your next professional years. So this plague, it takes three main forms. Pneumonic plague, it takes three stages: pneumonic, septicemic, and bubonic, right? Pneumonic means when it causes pneumonia like features, septicemia when it causes septicemia like features, right? It causes these ulcer, these skin swellings, and then bubonic, and this is septicemic, right? This is septicemic. In bubonic form, there is swelling of lymph nodes, and in septicemic forms, they turn black and die. In pneumonic, there is shortness of breath, cough, and chest pain. Right, so that completes your gram-negative bacteria. Let us move on to the bacteria who neither stains with gram-negative and neither stains with gram-positive. Right, so we have already learned mnemonic. Sea rascals, microscopically, they lack color. So S stands for spirochetes, R for rickettsia, M for mycobacteria and mycoplasma, L for legionella, C for chlamydia. Let us quickly finish the spirochetal diseases. Spirochetal diseases, normally the four bacteria, they affect these, they cause these spirochetal diseases. They are Leptospira, Borrelia, Brachyspira species and Treponema species. We will study the first and the last, Leptospira and Treponema. So Leptospira. Leptospira causes leptospirosis, right? This leptospirosis, the infected mammal, the rat, which contains the bacteria, right, that which infects, which causes the bacteria to pass into the water and soil and food, and the exposed human to those contaminated water, soil or food gets this leptospirosis, right? It is also called as Wheel's disease when it is in the severe form, right? When it is in the severe form. When it is in the mild form, it causes headaches, muscle pains and fever. When it is in severe forms, it causes bleeding in the lungs or it causes and meningitis, right? So Wheel's disease is dangerous, it is deadly and it causes death, right? The bleeding into the lungs is called by the leptospirosis is severe pulmonary hemorrhage syndrome and it can lead to death. So after leptospirosis we have in rickettsial, we have in spirochetal, we have syphilis. So syphilis is a sexually transmitted disease which is caused by the bacteria Treponema pallidum, right? Subspecies is pallidum. So Treponema pallidum, pallidum is the organism. So syphilis is again a sexually transmitted disease, right? We have studied Chancroid also a sexually transmitted disease, but that was a gram-negative bacteria. Now we are studying syphilis. Syphilis is caused by Treponema pallidum and which is nor a gram-positive nor a gram-negative bacteria, right? So this syphilis is a sexually transmitted disease and it has four stages, primary, secondary, and it may go into latent stage and then tertiary stage. So in primary stage, the person who has got the infection through the sexual intercourse will develop a single chancre, right? Chancre is a single painless non-itchy skin ulceration, right? So see this, right? This ulceration, it will be single, it will not be multiple. So this single ulceration, which is painless, there will be no pain, right? So this painless feature is the phenomena of syphilis, whereas the ulceration, multiple ulceration with pain is the phenomena of Chancroid, which is caused by Haemophilus tuesday. Right? A quick recap. Right? Haemophilus tuesday, the ulcerations will be multiple and they will be painful. Whereas in this, there will be no pain. So in primary stage, the single ulceration will be there over the genital organs. Then in secondary stages, the rash will occur and which will frequently involve palms of the hands and soles and feet, soles of the feet, right? See, the skin rashes, the small papules, macules and papules, skin rashes. Then we have latent syphilis, where the syphilis after primary and secondary stage will be resolved. It will be resolved but it will be there, the bacteria will be present in the body and it may last for many years and there will be very less symptoms because the person has not taken the treatment, the person has not taken the proper antibiotics, the person will go into latent syphilis and this latent syphilis may activate in later stages of life and may cause a tertiary syphilis. In tertiary syphilis, the syphilis will start affecting the other organs, right? Other organs like heart, it will cause cardiovascular syphilis. Other organs like nervous system, and it will cause neurosyphilis. It will be, the tertiary syphilis will be having gummas. These are soft non-cancerous growths. See these gummas, they will look like a cancerous growth, but they will be soft and they will be non-cancerous growth. So these gummas and the involvement of the heart and the CNS is indicative of tertiary syphilis. Then we have, after spirochetal disease, we have rickettsial infection. So rickettsial infections, the rickettsia organism, the rickettsia bacteria generally resides in animals. It's a zoonotic, it causes a zoonotic infection. So it resides in tick, it resides in mite, you know, these ticks and mites, the fleas, right? These are small parasites, ectoparasites. These are small parasites which generally infects the animals, right? But they might bite the humans as well. And there are louses, the head louse. Then the rickettsia. The rickettsia, these organisms, the rickettsial organisms, they generally causes many diseases grouped as spotted fever group. For example, Rocky Mountain spotted fever. Why it is called a spotted fever? Because it produces small spots over the body. Rocky Mountain spotted fever. The typhus group, which causes the typhus fever, right? There is one typhoid fever and there is typhus fever as well. The typhus fever is caused by rickettsia and it requires different antibiotics than typhoid, right? So typhoid fever and typhus fever. Then we have scrub typhus group, which causes scrub typhus, right? So these are some of the, and they'll be mostly present, these organisms, the most common feature will be fever, right? Fever, headache, myalgias, nausea, vomiting, cough, right? And these fevers, the rickettsial groups, the rickettsial fevers, they'll mostly be present with a maculopapular or vesicular rash, right? A skin rash, small dots over the skin. Then we have mycobacterial infections. After spirochetal infections and rickettsial infections, we have mycobacterial infections. Mycobacteria, we have already studied mycobacteria tuberculi, which causes tuberculosis. And we already know that this tuberculosis is a huge disease burdening thing over the world, right? So this tuberculosis bacteria, the mycobacterias, have a special mycolic acid in their cell wall. And this mycolic acid, it is a waxy layer. It acts as a waxy layer around the cell of the tuberculi, mycobacterium tuberculi. So it resists staining with the gram stain. So we have already studied that we have a different stain to stain the mycobacteria tuberculi, and that is acid fast stain, right? Acid fast stain by Zeal-Nielsen, by the scientists Zeal and Nielsen. So that is also called a Zeal-Nielsen staining. Acid fast staining or Zeal-Nielsen staining. So these tuberculosis, mycobacteria tuberculi, they mostly go into the lungs and causes pulmonary tuberculosis. However, from the pulmonary site, from the primary site of the lungs, they might transfer to other sites, or primarily they could affect directly the other sites also. So when they affect the other sites other than pulmonary, we call it as extrapulmonary tuberculosis, right? Extrapulmonary tuberculosis. For example, this tuberculoid bacteria, they might affect the lymph glands and they might cause lymphadenitis, which is tuberculous lymphadenitis. They might affect pleura, pleural TB, genitourinary TB, right? Skeletal TB, right? They causes infection in the skeletal tissue. Then we have spinal TB, very commonly seen spinal TB, which is also called as Pott's disease, right? Spinal TB mostly affects these vertebral column, right? Tuberculous meningitis, tuberculoma gastrointestinal tuberculosis, right? Pericardial tuberculosis, right? So they might affect different organs. They might affect heart, they might affect the abdomen, they might affect the meninges, they might affect the vertebral column, they might affect the skeletal tissue also, the different bones also, they might infect, right? It is one of the most common diseases among HIV infected person. HIV infected persons are more prone to get tuberculosis. We have vaccine for tuberculosis that is called as BCG. BCG vaccine, Bacillus Calmette Urine vaccine, which is given at 1 month of life. Then we have next bacteria, which causes leprosy. So leprosy, we will study about this in detail because this is a very big topic. Leprosy, right? You just remember, the leprosy looks something like this. The hypopigmented skin patches, will develop, right? The bacteria is again the Mycobacterium leprae, right? So poorly pigmented, numb skin patches, because this leprosy, it infects the central nervous system, right? So person will be having hypopigmented areas with numbness. If anybody is having such, if any patient is having such clinical manifestations, you should first be suspicious of leprosy. And the immediate treatment of leprosy is very much useful for the patient. Otherwise, patient might go into a situation like this, right? Where the skin, the organs, the hand structures, the fingers start falling, right? So this bacillary, leprosy is of two types: Posse bacillary leprosy, and it might cause multibacillary leprosy, right? We will study about this in detail later on, but you just remember that leprosy is a mycobacterial disease. It is also called as Hansen's disease, and the tuberculosis is also called as Koch's disease. Then we have non-tuberculous mycobacteria. So apart from mycobacteria, apart from tuberculosis and leprosy, apart from tuberculosis, there are certain bacteria which do not cause tuberculosis, but they are mycobacteria. For example, we have already studied the Mycobacterium leprae, right, which causes leprosis. Apart from leprae, we have Mycobacterium bovis, which generally infects the cows, right? Mycobacterium caprae, these can also infect the humans also. And most important, MAC, Mycobacterium avium complex, which causes pneumonia, right? Mycobacterium, which contains this Mycobacterium avium complex, contains Mycobacterium intracellular and Mycobacterium avium, right? So this mycobacteriosis is commonly seen in HIV cases. And why we are studying this non-tuberculous mycobacteria? Because these mycobacteria also stain positive with, also stain red with Ziehl-Neelsen stain, right? So they also stain with Ziehl-Neelsen stain. So sometimes there might be confusions, there might be confusions between tuberculous and non-tuberculous mycobacteria, and we have to rule it out, right? So these mycobacteria also causes pulmonary diseases, right, resembling tuberculosis, lymphadenitis. Then important, disseminated disease, right? Disseminated disease means it causes symptoms which are widespread, like malaise, fever, weight loss, organomegaly, lymphadenopathy, anemia, right? But tuberculi, the Mycobacterium tuberculi is not present in them, right? And it can be compared to the tuberculosis, it can be easily managed, right? So it is very important to find out whether the mycobacteria is tuberculi mycobacteria or non-tuberculous mycobacteria. Then after mycobacterial infections, we have mycoplasma infections, right? So they are not mycobacterial. They don't cause tuberculosis, leprosis, and non-tuberculosis mycobacteria. They are mycoplasmas, right? So these mycoplasmas are very peculiar because they are the only group of bacteria among all the bacteria which lacks a cell wall. Right, so they don't have a cell wall, and because most of the antibiotics or many antibiotics like cycloserine, like penicillin, like cephalosporin, like vancomycin, all these antibiotics, they work on the cell wall. They break the cell wall and exposes the bacteria to the outside structure, to the outside fluid of the body, and that leads to the lysis of the bacteria automatically because the bacteria is having hyperosmolarity in them. The bacteria are hypoosmolar, they are having more osmolarity in them. So whenever they are exposed directly to the body fluids, they burst by themselves. They get destroyed by themselves. So the antibiotics, they breaks the cell wall, or they inhibit the formation of the cell wall, thereby acting as bacteriolytic agents. Right? So these mycoplasma don't have cell wall, so they are easy to deal with. And mycoplasma pneumoniae is the important cause of pneumonia, right? It is also called as atypical pneumonia, walking pneumonia, right? It is a community acquired pneumonia. And it is called as atypical pneumonia because the typical features of the pneumonias are absent, right? So it will be atypical. The person will be having mild fever, headache, sweating, myalgia, and in an X-ray you can find the bronchopneumonia type of distribution of pneumonia, right? Not one lobe but entire lobe. See, mostly in this part the lower lobe is infected. You can see the opacities here and you can see the opacities here, here and here also, right? So the bronchopneumonia type of X-rays, whenever the X-rays, whenever they predict bronchopneumonia, it is atypical pneumonia, mostly caused by mycoplasma group. Then we have Legionella infections. Legionella infections, right? So the Legionella infections, they mostly produces pneumonia-like symptoms, pneumonia-type illnesses. They also causes atypical pneumonias and mild flu-like illnesses, and they are called as pontic fever. The diagnosis is made as pontic fever whenever Legionella infections are there, right? So these Legionella, they are mostly found in cooling towers and swimming pools. Cooling towers means like your water tanky over your floor, over your roof, right? So the water tank over your roof, the cooling systems, the RO plants, the swimming pools, the domestic water systems, ice creams, right? So we generally get this Legionella infections from such source. Then we have Chlamydia infections. Chlamydia infections are also important because this is these causes sexually transmitted disease, right? And Chlamydia infections are the common infections which are the cause for infertility in women, right? Because these infections, they go into the fallopian tubes and they block the fallopian tubes. So they are the most important cause of, or the most common cause of infertility in women, right? They also cause pelvic inflammatory diseases in women, right? And these Chlamydia infections, they are sexually transmitted disease. The bacteria is Chlamydia trachomatis. This Chlamydia trachomatis also causes infection of the other organs also, for example, eyes, right? And you can see these the infections in the lower lid of the eye, right? And these infections, these small lesions, right, might cause the damage to the cornea and might lead to the blindness. So Chlamydia infections are the major cause for blindness, right? For infectious causes for blindness. You will study them in your Shalakya classes. So repeated infections of the eyes, right, which are not treated well in time, may lead to blindness. So Chlamydia infections are important, where they causes the STDs, sexually transmitted disease, and blindness, right? So let us summarize what we have studied. We have studied bacterias, right? So bacterias are prokaryotic infectious agents, right? Bacterias are classified differently. They can be classified by staining methods. They can be classified by morphology, right? Based on the size, based on the shape, the cocci, the bacilli, the spiral shape and other shapes, right? Comma shapes. And anatomically means the organs they infect. For example, if they are infecting CNS, so CNS infections, bacterial infections, the urinary tract infections, the respiratory tract infections. You will study this anatomical division mostly in your higher classes, right? Right now we are concerned with the staining because this is a pathology class. So Gram staining, positive, negative, and others. We have studied, apart from Gram stain, we have studied the acid fast stain also, which is for mycobacteria. Always remember mycobacteria, all types of mycobacteria. Then positive Gram stains and negative Gram stains, right? Positive Gram stains, bacteria produces exotoxins. Both types of, in fact, all types of bacteria produces exotoxins, whereas endotoxins are characteristically produced by just negative Gram stain, negative bacteria, and they are more dangerous because of this feature, because of the production of endotoxin. Then negative Gram stain are more dangerous. Then bacteria has cell wall made up of peptidoglycans, and we also studied that these cell walls are destroyed by the antibiotics. Thank you.